Hey, welcome to this new episode of Understanding Gradle. In the videos about Java modularity so far, we have looked at the class path and the module path from several perspectives and learned how these concepts are used to compose an application from modules and to control the visibility of modules, either by using Gradle on top of the class path or by using the module path in Java directly. While the class path basically allows you to put any jar or folder on it, the module path is more restrictive, as we've learned in the last video. So not every artifact that is jar or zip file you get from a repository might work well on the module path. While Java itself has some fallback mechanisms to make these things work as a kind of intermediate solution while moving to a full Java module setup, it is not how the module path is intended to be used in the end. That's why this is a good example where you would like to adjust jar files that you get from an external repository. For this, Gradle has a feature built into the dependency management called artifact transforms. This allows you to do exactly that. Transform, which is modify, extend, or reduce an existing file, so for example an existing jar file, before it is used by tasks or tools like the IDE. So in this video, we'll learn about the artifact transform concept and use the case of transforming existing legacy jar files into proper Java modules as an example. We'll learn how we can write such a transform ourselves, and I will show you another of the Gradle X plugins, the Extra Java Module Info plugin, which contains an implementation of such a transform that you can use without having to implement it yourself. Let's start by looking at an example. Here I have a simple project that only contains one Java module, which is called app. In this example, we would like to use three existing Java libraries: the SLF4J API, Apache Commons Text, and Apache Commons Lang. If we don't use any additional plugins, like the Java Module Dependencies plugin we learned about in the previous video, I need to define the dependencies directly as it's typical for Gradle builds. So I add these three dependency declarations to my build file. Then in my module info file, I can say that my Java module here requires the three Java modules that are in the jars to which I just defined the dependencies. Now, for demonstration purposes, I just have one class in my application, which contains the main method. Here, we now add code that uses the reflection over the Java module system to print out some information about our modules to see some specifics. Let's print out the path to the jar, where the module is located on disk, and the packages the modules export. Remember from my previous videos that when you do Java modules, you export packages explicitly in your module info file. Otherwise, other modules won't see anything that's inside these packages, and all the content is effectively private to other modules. Now, if we run this code and look at the information that we printed, we can see that seemingly neither Commons Text nor Commons Lang exports any packages. Still, in our code, we were able to use classes from these packages, like caseUtils or stringUtils. Let's have a look at the jar file of Commons Text. If we look inside, we see that there is no module info class. Remember that each proper Java module has a module info class file that contains exactly the information we are looking for. Which packages does the module export, and which other modules does it require to compile and run? That the module info class is missing is an indication that Commons Text has not yet fully prepared to be a Java module. Let's also look into the manifest file. If we search through it, we can see that there is an automatic module name entry. This is one of the intermediate mechanisms Java provides to move existing libraries to the Java module system. By this, the developers of Commons Text already find a name for their module without caring about all the details that would have to go in the module info Java file. Modules that are defined like that only through the name in the manifest are called automatic modules, and Java explicitly knows if a module is an automatic module at compile time and runtime, and it treats them in a special way. This is needed because we don't know the requires and the exported packages for these modules, so Java has to make some assumptions. I won't go into all the details on special cases in this video, but one thing to remember is that as soon as you have automatic modules on the module path, certain things don't work anymore. For example, tools like the Jlink tool and the JDK only work with real modules, and the goal of the module system is that eventually you should use real Java modules with proper module info classes in them completely on the module path. And then you have a setup as intended by the Java module system. Everything else is just compromises with the intent to ease the transition from an existing class path-based setup to a complete module path setup. To show one example of such issues, if we go to our module info file and remove the requires to commonslang, our example still works. So we can use commonslang even though we didn't add a requires to it. The cause of this is that all automatic modules effectively transitively require all the other automatic modules. Because Java doesn't have any of the requires information for the automatic modules, it assumes that everything needs to see everything, which is similar to the situation we had on the class path. And now if I write a real module with a module info Java and require one of these automatic modules, this automatically pulls in the whole bunch of automatic modules. So you see how this negates the whole idea of the module path by bringing in class path concepts into it again. Eventually, of course, it would be great if commons text and commons lang and all the other Apache commons libraries would be turned into Java modules in one of the next versions. But right now, we have to deal with the situation as it is. Instead of putting jars, which are not real modules, on the module path and having Java to deal with this imperfect module setup, we can use Gradle and, in particular, artifact transforms to enhance the jars to make them into proper modules before we put them on the module path, so Java doesn't have to activate this legacy migration mechanisms to deal with imperfect modules on the module path. What is an artifact transform and how is it activated? You can compare transforms to tasks. So basically a unit of work that has some input and some output. And mechanisms like up-to-dateness and caching also work for transforms like they work for tasks. The difference between tasks and transforms is how they are scheduled and put into the chain of actions Gradle executes when a build configures and runs. From a certain perspective, transforms always run before tasks because they are part of the dependency resolution. So they may modify artifacts before they become an input to a task. For example, because they are on the compile class path, which is an input to the Java compile task. Let's first implement a transform that solves our specific use case of turning commons text and commons lang into Java modules. A transform, like a task, is implemented as an abstract class. I'll do it here in Kotlin, but you can use any JVM language like Java or Groovy. This class implements the transform action interface. It can optionally also have parameters defined in a separate interface. Then each transform has exactly one input artifact. You can access that by defining an abstract property or an abstract getter in Java, which you annotate with the input artifact annotation. And then you implement the transform method from the transform action interface, in which you implement the work the transform should do in case it is triggered. So this is comparable to the task action if you would implement a task. The method has the transform outputs as an argument through which you define what the transform produces. This is flexible. A transform may, for example, do nothing and just return the input artifact as an output. It may also transform to nothing and return empty outputs, or it may produce several output files or directories. In our example, we have two cases. Either a jar is already a module, which is the case for SLF4j API in our example, or it is not yet a module, so we want to create a new jar that contains the contents of the original jar plus the module info class file. To not make this example too complex, I have prepared the module info class file for commons text and commons lang here in the resources folder, so that in the transform, we can just put these existing files into the transform jar. To look into jar files, we can inject the archive operations service from Gradle. We use it here to check if a module info class file already exists. If it is the case, we set our existing input artifact as the output of the transform, which effectively means that the transform will do no work, so write no new files or anything like that. In the other case, we create a new file. We modify the name a little bit to make it easier to distinguish, so we add a dash module to the name of the file, and then we iterate through the entries of the jar file, which is our input artifact, and put all the entries into the new jar file. In addition, we find the module info class in our resources. and then we add that to the newly created jar file. With this, we have implemented a complete artifact transform in Gradle. Remember, the transform concept is a general concept that you could use to transform any file that you get through Gradle's dependency management. Using it to extend or modify jar files is just one example. Now that we have an artifact transform, how do we tell Gradle to use it? Similar to tasks, transforms are triggered based on their inputs and outputs. In the case of tasks, each task has arbitrary many files and folders as inputs and outputs, and the tasks are connected by directly connecting such outputs and inputs. For transforms, it's a bit more restrictive because they need to fit into the dependency resolution concepts of Gradle. We've seen in the implementation that the transform always has one input artifact. In addition to this, you can say that the transform also has attributes as inputs and outputs. We talked about this concept already in different videos on dependency management topics. And also when we looked at how Gradle distinguishes the compile and the runtime class path in Java modularity, this concept was seen. Because basically an attribute is used to tell Gradle which variation of a certain component or a certain artifact you need. For example, at compile time, you want to see less dependencies than at runtime. So in these cases, the attributes are used to decide for Gradle how the dependency graph is built up, so which components or modules end up on your class paths in the end at all. But after selecting a certain component, there's a second step in the resolution where Gradle looks at which artifacts are actually behind this component. Typically in Java, there's only one jar file, but in other cases, there could also be multiple files behind one component. And the attributes can also be used on this level to decide if an artifact fits what is needed. And if it doesn't, a transform might be triggered to convert an artifact into the required format if you want. Now, how does it look concretely? Again, such setup is best done in a basic convention plugin that is applied to all projects in your build, so that you have the same behavior everywhere. In our case now, we need a new attribute to distinguish between jars that are not Java modules and jars that are Java modules. We call it Java module and make it of type Boolean. And now we say that both our compile class paths and our runtime class paths should be made up of jars that are Java modules. If we execute the build now, the introduction of this new attribute doesn't make a difference, because Gradle does not yet know how the attribute relates to existing artifacts, so it just ignores it. We can make this connection by accessing the artifact types. Through this, you can basically say that an artifact of a certain type, which is defined through the file extension, in our case jar, has additional attributes by default. So in this case, we say all artifacts of type jar are not Java modules, because we don't know yet if they are or not. If we run a build now, we get an error, because we said on the one hand that on the class paths, we want jars that are Java modules. On the other hand, we said that all our jars are not Java modules. And this is where the transform comes into play. We can now register our transform with the register transform method. Similar to how we register a task, we give the type of our transform here. Since we haven't defined any additional parameters, the only thing we need to do here is to configure from which set of attributes the transform transforms to which other set of attributes. So we say we transform from jars that are not Java modules to jars that are Java modules. And if you remember the implementation of our transform, this transformation can also mean that we detect that a jar is already a Java module, and so just gives the confirmation this is a Java module. If we run our example code now, it works again. And we can see that comments text and comments lang now export packages, which is the information we added to the jars through our prepared module info class files for these libraries. We can also see that the jars used here are now located in a different position in the Gradle cache. So Gradle runs the transform and also caches the result of the transform. So similar to the up-to-date check for tasks, the transform won't run again until something changes. And also, if we inspect the dependencies from Gradle in the IDE, you can see that now our transform jars are turning up here. The example transform we developed required us to prepare the module info class files that we wanted to extend the jars with. To have this more practical, we developed the extra Java module info plugin. This plugin is working very similar to our example, but has more features and is more complete. And it allows you to define the module info content directly in your Gradle file. So if we use the plugin, again, by defining a dependency in the build Gradle file of our convention plugins project, and then applying the plugin in our base convention plugin, we can now directly define the information for the module info files here in our Gradle convention plugin with a notation similar to what you would write into the module info files. With this plugin, you can conveniently extend existing jars that are not yet Java modules to be real Java modules to be used on the module path. This allows you to set up full Java module projects with all the advantages of the Java module system today, even though many existing and widely used libraries do not yet contain module info class files. In this video, we've explored artifact transforms on the example of jar files that we want to use on the module path, but which miss the module info class file. Remember that, as all dependency management concepts in Gradle, artifact transforms are also generic and not bound to Java. You can use them in a completely different context where you get other artifacts from repositories. So the attribute concept, you can flexibly put in artifact transforms into existing setups and combine them with existing Gradle plugins. Regarding the module path, we have seen that Java allows to put jars without module info onto the module path. However, this is only possible because additional compatibility mechanisms in Java get activated to support these migration use cases. In my experience, this can lead to a lot of surprising and hard to understand behavior, as we have also seen in the small example already. That's why my recommendation is that if you want to use the Java module system, use only dependencies that are real Java modules. And if you really need to use libraries that are not Java modules yet, use Gradle with the extra Java module plugin to add the missing information to these jars. Please subscribe to the channel to get notified when new videos are available. See you next time.